Gracious and loving God, we come before you with thanksgiving and praises. We come before you because you have done so much for us.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't know why you love us so much. This is the time to hear your word. I pray that Lord Jesus, you hide me behind the cross and bring forth your word to your people. My prayer is that anything that is not from you, Lord, you hide it and speak to your people the words they can hear. Take control of my tongue and communicate clearly to everyone so they can hear and be doers. In the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Give the young people a chance. Give the young people a chance. One of the three most important issues that will be before us in the weeks ahead, the months ahead, that we need to make sure we work on is the youth, the young people. The others will be prayer and the worship, praise and worship in our church. Yes, when the SPPRC committee met me the first time, it was an issue that they were worried about. And it's an issue that every United Methodist Church should be worried about. The issue of the young people. Where are the young people? Why is it that there is so big gap, such a big gap that we can't find them? When I speak with people, I can feel that they all have different take and answers, saying that, oh, these days, maybe people don't like, it's too expensive to live in the city. Maybe these days, the kids just move out. They give different reasons. But I will try to make sure that they have a space in our church. Because if we don't resolve it now, then all the work that all of you have been doing may be in vain. The truth is this, that if you don't see the young people and you go to a church 3 blocks away from you and you see a lot of young people, you should ask yourself, why are the young people not finding the space here? As I was talking with one of you, we were chatting, he said, maybe let's start from the few young we have. We need to hear from them exactly why they are not here. Is it because of our worship? Is it because of something else? Once we know we can, that is why down the road, there's going to be a time for us, for me to meet the leaders. There will be a time for me to meet the entire congregation. There will be a questionnaire that we will prepare and send out for people to respond. And then there will be also a time to gather only the young ones among us to hear from them, to see where we go from there. And so the topic before us this morning is very clear. The young people. And my point is that give them a chance. Give them a chance. The text is from Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 6, and part of verse 6 and verse 7. Alas, sovereign Lord, I said, I do not know how to speak, and I'm too young. But the Lord said, do not say, I am too young. Wow. Conversation between God and a young man. The name of the young man is Jeremiah. So see the picture clear. God is having a conversation with a young man. Why would God choose among so many elderly, knowledgeable people, scribes, people who know the word, bypass all of them and come to Jeremiah, a young man? And he's saying that, I'm giving you an assignment. Later on, I will touch base to see the nature of the assignment, how tough it was, and how you begin to realize that, hey, we may think that assignment before us as Freeport United Methodist Church is a tough one, but you have no idea that there may be a young man God has prepared in our congregation to help us a way forward. Who is this young man? Jeremiah. Well, Jeremiah is one of the prophets, the major prophets, who I always sympathize with. There were so many prophets who prophesied against the nation of Israel, Judah, that you are going wayward. God wants you to return to him. God wants you to come back, change your ways, of worshiping the Baals and the idols, which are no God. Idols that you go cut a wood in the forest, use part for firewood, and you sharpen that other part, and you tell that wood that you brought me out of Egypt. God detested that. He sent prophets to go warn the people of Israel, but they will not listen. Jeremiah is the one of the few prophets, some actually like Ezekiel and Daniel, found themselves in exile. But Jeremiah is the prophet who saw it coming, warned the people that they should change their ways. They never changed their ways. They never. And so he prophesied to them that there is danger. They didn't listen. He saw the danger coming when Babylonians came to Egypt and came to Judah, destroyed Jerusalem, the temple, desecrated the temple, and eventually shipped many of them into exile. For 50 years, Jeremiah was preaching to the nation to repent and change their ways, and they will not listen. And the truth of the matter is that because they will not change their ways and follow their foolish ways, their society was deteriorating socially, economically, politically, and spiritually, because God was abandoning them. God was abandoning them. God saw that they were stubborn people who will not change their ways. And so for 50 years, Jeremiah was preaching to them, repent and you'll change your ways. God will change the punishment he's going to bring to you. Preaching repentance, but the people of Judah will not listen. But they will continue their foolish ways. Let us listen to the dialogue, the interaction between God and Jeremiah, so that you can see that God may have a young man among us, and we need to make sure we give them a chance for them to thrive and save our congregation. Verse 4, listen. The word of the Lord came to me saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Oh, what a statement. It gives you an idea that each one of us, before we were formed, God knew what we were going to do. God actually has given us an assignment. Sometimes we don't listen. And so we don't hear God speak to us because we are busy trying to chase all the monies in the world. We are busy trying to hear that if we get so many PhDs, so many degrees, so many this, so many that, we'll be okay in life. But that's only part of the story. You should always ask yourself, what is God's purpose in my life? And until you come to that space where you discover God's purpose in your life, you may be chasing the wind. You may be a businessman or woman, but in that purpose, God is calling you to do something unique and special. You may be a teacher. In the teaching, God is calling you to do something unique, special. It may be that you're an engineer, you're a medical doctor, you're a professor, you're a nurse, you're a pharmacist, name them. In that calling, God has assignment for you to do. Do you ask yourself every day, what is God's purpose in my life? And am I doing what God wants me to do? He said, before I formed you, he told Jeremiah, I knew you. Wow. And before you were born, I set you apart for something great. Now listen to the response of Jeremiah. Oh Lord, not me. Alas, alas, sovereign Lord, I said, I don't know how to speak. Let's end it there. You are sending me to this stubborn people called Israelites, the Jews, those from Judah. They're too stubborn. Listen, I don't know how to find those sweet words to convince them. I don't know how to speak, Lord. And then he said, and then plus, I am too young. Look at my age. Look at me. Look at me. Jeremiah's age at that time was not named, but for the next 50 years, about 5 kings that he had to serve under for 50 years, it tells you the truth. He was young. He was young. He said, I am too young. But listen to what God says. Do not say, I am too young. You have no choice. You must go to everyone I send you to And sometimes he sent them to kings and people who were ready to kill him, you know. Do not say, but I will send you to whatever I command you. And he said, do not be afraid, for I am with you and I will rescue you, declares the Lord. The Lord's promise is always to help us through as individuals, as congregation. The Lord's promise is to be our God and we be his people. As long as we have put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ, we have a covenant with God. God offers to be your God. And God offers to protect and supply your need. And we are his people. But let me tell you how tough the assignment is. I will run away fast. I will tell God that, no matter what you say, this is too much. If you read verse 10, it's a tough assignment. And I'm reading for the NIV, New International Version. It says, see, today I appoint you over nations. Yeah. It was not only Judah, but Assyria, Edomites, Moabites, Amorites, even Egypt, even Babylon. He was prophesying over them and he said, I appoint you over nations and kingdoms. Now listen to the nature of the job. To uproot anything I have not planted, which means all the idol worshiping and all the vices that they were practicing, your duty is to uproot them. To uproot and to tear down. Tough job. To destroy, to overthrow, and then to build and to plant. We don't have time to itemize them and go through them by one. But if you sit down and you imagine this, the question is that, God, why are you calling a young man to do the job? That is what God does all the time. Because when he calls a young man, he knows what he has put into the young man. He knows the value, what the young man can do, and he knows what an old man can do, an old woman can do. He knows that the young man has energy and the toughness. And by the way, same way he calls Samuel over Eli, he chose David, a small boy, to kill Goliath when Saul and all the veterans were there. My friend, there is so much in young people that we should give them a chance, friends. Like I told you, the job was tough to rebuild Freeport. Rebuilding Freeport is in the hands of the young people. Why not let them give them the chance right now? Last Wednesday, I went we went to an office to do something, and you have pasted some information that you need to use your phone camera to take a picture and fill a form. I saw a woman and her son. He came, the woman adjusted this way for me, adjusted this way, doing this and that. And for maybe the next 30 seconds, he can't take one picture. And I could see myself in the woman. I want to get it right and take the shot. Her son just got a little frustrated. He took the camera from the mother like he was the husband. He just went there, boom. What? I'm saying that, oh my goodness. Yes, he took the picture without thinking. And so why is it that we think that these kids don't have value? So much that we can't give them a chance. I've seen a 3-year-old child take a phone. She doesn't know the password. Open the phone and go to the place where, you know, she normally loved to see kids' things. I couldn't even believe it. I don't even know my phone where to go to, except somebody showed me that, oh, go here, go there, and go there, you go there. No, these kids know what to do. Why are we thinking that they have nothing and therefore we are not giving them the chance to help Freeport United Methodist Church stand on its feet? Give the young people a chance. You and I, we need to cultivate a space whereby they will see that they have a space here to thrive. These days, if you don't know the young people, you may be sitting at a table with them, right? They may be six, they will be five, whatever. They will be talking against you, they are texting about you. They know how to communicate in ways that, you know, you can't even believe. They want to have a function, they can plan one in 15 minutes. And they will be there. In my other church, all of a sudden, I heard some people talking that, listen, these young people, when they come to church, they are on their phone. They are on their phone. And so they were going to, I said, stop it. I prefer that they are in church with their phones rather than they never come into the church at all. And by the way, they can multitask. Please forgive me. I can't multitask. If I try to do two things at the same time, one is going to go somewhere else. One will go south. One will go the wrong way. So I am asking that we begin to stop and begin to see the value in our young people and give them a space to thrive, right? They were going to make an issue. I said, no, listen, when you come to church, if you are one of those people who say that, I want you to focus on God, focus on the message that is coming, focus on the hymns, focus on you lifting God's hand and praising God. Don't worry about somebody else. So with some people, they think that when everything is quiet and still, that's where God is. No, God is interested in your heart. What is going on in your heart? Because you come in to hear all these words, but you still have bitterness against your own Christian brother, sister, friend. What is going on in your heart? So the thing is that concentrate, focus on yourself and how you come to that space to worship instead of looking around and see who is on the phone. Listen, let me tell you, the kids that you complain that they have phones, right? They have phones in the church. If you ask them, they can tell you what they heard. But the adults who are complaining, they can't say one word. They may not remember one word. One word. One word. Please give the young people a chance. Give them a chance. My friends, give them a chance. Let us hear what they think. Let us find ways to create a space for them. I would love for them to come and have games, have fun nights, and when they finish, just 3 minutes, ask them, you know, ask me questions, and I will answer. And let me tell you, by the way, kids don't like this kind of sermon and preaching. So maybe when I see them coming, I will preach for only 5 minutes or 10 minutes. Why? They just want to know why they should serve God. They want to know why we should pray. They are not interested in me going observing what is going on in the scripture passage and the lessons and application. No, they are not interested. Why should I say God? And if it works, they are going to put into action. Friends, our future is in the hands of the young people. Give them a chance. Let's create an environment where they will love to stay and thrive. And once they thrive, our church will thrive. Many of you us take our young kids to basketball game and football game, and you sit and you watch how your child is growing and the skills he or she is developing. If he is playing with dad, he wants to dribble dad, and they sometimes succeed dribbling dad because they are faster than dad. Or mommy, right? Let's give them their chance. They have a lot of energy, but we are looking at them that they have nothing. No, they have a lot to offer. We have wisdom to guide them. We have the maturity to guide them. But let's allow them to be the space where they want to be and slowly help them to change, to transform. Give the young people a chance. And what are you doing personally to help the young people thrive? There are three things that I want to quickly let you know, and then I realize I may not be able to exhaust them the way I wanted to. One is this, that they need love. They also need encouragement. They need a space to thrive and a space where they will feel welcome. Not a space where they scream at them. One day in my other church, I heard that the young people were disconnected from us, at the adults. A new person who came in told me eventually they drove out. Okay. So I decided to put this young few one in front of the church so that they can tell their hearts, so that we adults will embrace them and see how best we can help them. You know what? The adults start, oh, they don't respect, they don't do this, they do that, they do this. Oh my God. Then I caused the problem. You know, I just wanted to hear from them so that we can have some sympathy and empathy, and as our own children, help them to thrive. Listen, we have a prophet from Africa, from Ghana specifically. If your little baby shits on your legs, you don't cut it away. You wipe it off. Many of us, our kids, we have shown so much love to them. They made mistakes, they do all kinds, but we show them, we love them. And therefore we see them growing and thriving and doing great things. Why can't all of us here treat the kids who come into Freeport United Methodist Church the way we have loved our kids at home? It may not be your blood kid, but they are kids of the congregation. How best we can help them. Know that, yes, it takes a village to raise a child. And the church is part of the village. The church is always part of the village. Church should contribute in helping these kids grow up. Many of the artists you see in the world, they started in the church, friends. And so every kid we see in a church is a potential for our church. Let's give him or her a chance to show a way into the youth world, the young world, and through that, begin to disciple them for Jesus. Give the young people a chance. Let's love them. Let's encourage them. And let us see how best we can create a space for them to thrive. May God help us. And may God himself open our eyes to be able to work with the young ones we have, so that by God's grace, we will see them rising up to show us, to give us clues by which we can bring many young people into our midst so they will thrive. May God be with us and bless us through and through in Jesus' name. Say amen. Let us pray. Now begin to see yourself. Do you find yourself empty? Have you seen yourself driving because of what you said, what you did? Somebody stopped coming, a young kid stopped coming to church. That is them. But now, what will you do if you see a young person in the church? How you think you will love him or her, encourage him or her to thrive in our church? How are we going to listen to listen to their struggles and help them? But sometimes I believe that sometimes Christ is not in the center of our lives. Sometimes I fear to say that. Some people stay long in the church, and so they try to behave like what somebody in church should behave. But the center piece of it is not behaving what a church person should. It's to be able to surrender totally to Christ and repent of your sin and allow Christ into your heart. If you allow Jesus into your heart, that peace and the joy you have helps you to reach out to the young people so that we can help them find home in our church and peace in our church and thrive in our church, so that someday when they become Secretary of State, presidents and things like that, we can remember that we played a part in their lives. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we want you to bring the young people back into our church. Sometimes we don't know where to find them, but we know that if you allow us or you lead us, we will find them. I pray that Jesus, we will give a listening ear to hear what the young ones want to say. Now people will take interest, personal interest, in creating a space for the young people to thrive. I am praying that Jesus, people will offer to be patrons, to support the kids or do great things in the church. People will offer to become youth leaders in the church, the young one, that they will show us how to bring their friends who are not church members, and they, once they see what they are doing, that they like it, become members of our church and bring their parents. Yes, Lord Jesus, it's a way that only you can help us. Only you can direct us. Please, I pray that Jesus help us and show us a way to do it. Right now, I bring Lord Jesus, a velataka to your throne of grace, that after a procedure that she will heal comfortably, perfectly well, that all will be well. I bring Marva to your throne of grace, that your healing grace will touch her and heal her completely, that all the challenges that the enemy has put in her way will disappear, and you pour your peace into her so that she is restored in the way you created her. Yes, and be with her. I am praying for Brenda, that you touch Brenda and continue to help her heal. I will pray that you touch Monica Fletcher, that Lord Margaret Lowy, and all those who are sick among us, the elderly, visit them, touch them, heal them. But above all, I am praying that you put Jesus, you bind us together in your love, that together we can listen to each other and begin to see where and how we can help the young people thrive in our congregation. Show us how to bring young people in Show us how to bring praise and worship into our church. Show us how we can bring prayer on a regular basis to our congregation and help us to make Christ the center of our lives. Thank you for hearing our prayer in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.